Welcome back to my channel. I'm here with a very, very special guest for a very, very special project. And if you've seen any of my videos before or seen it around on the internet, I'm here with Robbie with the Nashorn Restoration Project out of the Netherlands. And we're going to share a little bit of some updates about the project as well as some of the history of it and of the Nashorn itself. And then you get to find out what's next in store and how you can keep up. I'll turn it over to Robbie here so he can explain a little bit about what's going on and what you can expect.
Hello guys, I'm Robbie van Zambeek from the Netherlands, and I'm the team leader of the restoration of the Nashorn project, and this is the only Nashorn out of three in existence that is currently in driving condition. We still have a long way to go before it's more or less operational for events and everything, but yeah, we can drive, so we can go to events and show the Nashorn to the audience. The gun, it is mounted, but yeah, to be able to show it as it should be, we still have to make traversing elevation mechanism, we still have to make ammunition boxes, all that small stuff that's on the inside and that most people don't see, and also some little things on the outside.
Awesome. So our first speaking topic will be a little bit on the history of the vehicle.
This Nashorn was found in the Kaliningrad area in Russia, formerly known as Königsberg, where it was destroyed at the end of the Second World War. And it was found by a Russian collector. And yeah, we were looking around for a project for restoration. And he came up with the Nashorn. Some people asked us, why not a Panther tank? Well, it's not really like you go to a store and buy a tank. So yeah, you have to get what you can get. A lot of people think the chassis is based on the Panzer 3-4 design, but what I've understood from Hilary Doyle, it's not. It's purpose designed for Nashorn and Hummel. What they did at Alcat is the manufacturer that designed and built both Nashorn and Hummel. They looked at the parts that were available, and yeah, for the running gear it was Panzer 4 parts, and for the gearbox, final drive, differential, it was Panzer 3 parts. But the hulls of both vehicles were different. The Panzer 3 hull was wider than Panzer 4 hull. In the beginning we found it strange that the Nashorn hull was longer than the Panzer 4 while it was using the suspension parts of Panzer 4, but knowing that the hull was also wider than Panzer 4, it makes sense that they completely redesigned the hull, yeah, to accommodate all these parts.
Good, okay.
If you look at the vehicle, they always talk about early and late models. For the Nashorn, there are a few small details that makes it either early or late model. And one of the obvious part is the spare wheel holders. And the early models, if you see this model, here in front, for the early models, they have the spare wheel holders. And for the later models, they go to the back bottom part. So that's a really obvious detail of, yeah, that you can recognize an early or later model. But also a lot of small details. Like double headlights or single headlight in the middle. The single headlight is for a later model, the double headlight is for the early models. But you also have transitional pieces. Some things get changed in the field, like the muffler. They all were built, the early ones, with a muffler on the back. But it was also on the position where the crew has to get into the vehicle. And they were burning their feet on the muffler, so they took off the muffler in the field. So if you see one, it's probably a really early one. And but yeah, it can be like a later model as well. And another thing is the sprocket, so the gear in front. You see some with an early type of Panzer III sprocket. But that doesn't make it an early Nashorn, because those parts were just taken as they could get hold of it. So it is possible that you see a later model Nashorn with an early drive sprocket.
How many Nashorn did they make in total?
About 494.
Okay, and there's three left.
There's only three left.
And this is the only one that's running.
Yeah.
Gotcha. That's right, because the U.S. Army has one. And I imagine, where's the other one? Kubinka or something, huh?
It used to be a Kubinka, but now it's Patriot Park. It's just a new museum instead of Kubinka. I think Kubinka still exists. And what I've understood, the plans are to move about everything that Kubinka had to the new museum.
Right. What kind of condition was it when it arrived with you guys?
Just a few parts, broken pieces, a lot. The hull we found later on a website called Milweb in the UK, and that's really the site to go to. We are trying to buy military vehicles. And yeah, the hull, the bare hull was for sale on that website, so we were really lucky that we didn't have to build major parts.
How long has it been since you started the project?
We started collecting in 2015, so it's about 5 years now.
Okay, great. All right, so a lot of the people that have been following this project knows tragedy hit in 2019. What happened there?
Yeah, Sunday morning, March 10th, 2019, we got a call from a neighbor that the barn where the Nasrallah was stationed caught fire and completely burned down in 30 minutes.
You can see from some of the photos, a lot of the components were destroyed, and some things were left rebuildable, and some things had to be thrown out, and some things could be restored. So what are some of the things that you could keep after the fire?
Most steel parts that will survive a fire, they will lose some strength, but since it's not a fighting vehicle anymore, it's okay to use it. Leaf springs luckily didn't get that hot, so they didn't get bent, because when they get around 700 degrees centigrade, they will deform and you cannot use them anymore. But yeah, luckily that didn't get hot enough for getting destroyed. But like all rubber parts, they just burn off.
There is not only just the loss of the vehicle components, but as well, you can see here in some of the photos, a lot of tools and supplies that you guys had in the shed are also gone. So the fundraiser that we saw you guys come up with after that fire when you decided it was time to rebuild, a lot of that went to recouping some of that loss as well, yeah?
Yeah. Yeah, we recently bought a magnetic drill that can drill, you can place it on the side of a steel part and turn on an electromagnet and drill big holes. And that's a really big part of a restoration like this, because the parts are too big to go to a drill press and drill some holes. You can't lift them. So yeah, buying parts like that, machinery, welding equipment, plasma torch, lathe, all those things got lost.
You can see some of the extent of the damage, the road wheels. So you can keep some of the components for the road wheels. The steel stuff is there, but that rubber is absolutely destroyed.
Yeah, that's completely gone. So we had to buy all new ones, and yeah, they were made in Poland, so the price is really interesting. It's not very expensive, but still it's a lot of money.
Right here with the transmission and the engine. So are the transmission and the engine parts original?
No, unfortunately not, but we would really love to get original parts, but it's so expensive. You're talking about 250,000 euros for all those parts, including restoration. And yeah, buying something else is a lot cheaper, and especially if you're going to drive it and it breaks down, it will cost that money again.
Right.
And now it's really cheap to get it back in working order if something breaks. The final draft, the steering unit you can see in the front, the gray part, that's from a FE-432, so a British armored personnel carrier. And then the engine and the gearbox is from a dragline crane, and it's a Dutch V12. So they're known for reliability, and they will always work.
Has it been working well for you since being able to get it up and moving again?
Yeah, we had some minor issues with a fuel line that wasn't really closed up properly, but yes,
okay.
Easy to.
And there's the new road wheels. How did you get that many new road wheels for it?
The rubbers were newly made. So we had to cut off the steel bands on which the rubber was coated. and you pressed them back on the original steel wheels. So the wheels were still original, the bearings were still in good condition because the firemen were very fast at the scene and could put out the fire reasonably quick. Of course, at that time it's never fast enough, but it did save a lot on the damage.
And there's some tracks. So I know that you've mentioned on some of your on your social media and on your YouTube page that you've had some trouble with the tracks.
Some people ask us, is it because of the fire? But we think it's not, because the tracks are breaking on a point that's similar to tracks that you find in the ground. And I have one example here. This one is still in reasonable shape. It's a bit bent, but I don't know if the camera can pick it up. There's a big crack here.
Oh, yeah.
And they're all breaking on that point. And if it was due to the fire, those brakes should have been different to what you can find in the ground.
Gotcha.
So for that reason, we think it's not because of the fire. And then usually a fire attacks the strength of a track and it makes it softer, so it would bend and or harden and give a different brake surface. I have another one here. That one we had on the first time driving at Overloon. You can see it's completely broken. And there's a video on my channel. It's better to see on that one. And if you want to use the footage over, you can. And you can see inclusions from casting. So it was also a bad design, and the sender guides were open. And the later, all later models from all manufacturers, they made the sender guides closed, so they're a lot stronger. So all that tells us that it's a manufacturing problem.
So how are you going to get all brand new track for this thing?
There's a company in the UK that restores World War II vehicles, and they are working on getting new tracks made for, I think, about 18 months now, and they're very close to getting them in production. And hopefully early this year, we will get a full set from them for testing.
Cool. So that's
And
something
we'll.
that's like what the GoFundMe helps you guys get is like buy brand new track and things like that, right?
Yeah.
Cool. Okay. Here you can see some destroyed set of return rollers. There's a really interesting process that you shared a little bit on your YouTube and on your socials as well about how you guys got new return rollers after these things are completely destroyed.
Yeah, the return rollers we still have to make the rubber parts for, but a fellow restorer in Poland, he currently restored two Stuk 3s. He has two 5.1s, and he had the steel return rollers for the later type. And he just told us, here you have a full set. They still need some work. I have a video on that, and we restore them so we could use them in the meantime, till we get the rubbers sorted for ours.
And then tell me a little bit about this the project that you had with Borden that they helped you with the modeling for the casts.
Yeah, they are restoring the flak panzer at the moment. So they saw the fire and they asked if they could help us. One of the guys, he is a CAD designer, and he made drawings for the rubber part. And currently that part is being 3D printed so that we can put it on the wheel and make a mold out of it and then cast the new rubbers.
That's cool. It's cool to see the community all come together like that. Can you show me the cast for the bump stops?
Yeah, I've got one here. This is the bottom side. So when the vehicles go through a hole and the wheel is riding up again, it can slam against this, and these two holes, they will bolt into the vehicle. And this is also a part that we made ourselves. What we found, the original ones, the bottom plate often came off, so we changed it a little bit to make it a bit more sturdy, and we welded a piece of round stock on it. So even if it comes loose, then it still will be attached to the original part. And for the top one, it got two holes inside for with threads, and they often were still with the vehicle, with the rubber, but we welded T-nuts on it to give them a little bit more strength. So even though they can come loose, not likely, but they will stay attached to the vehicle. And then for casting, you have to find out what best place to cast them to make a mold. And with this one, you can still see the seam. So it has two vertical seams. And because this ridge on top and bottom, it means that you can't take the mold off this way because it will hook up. So I made this mold, it's a two part. On top, the ridge is cast in the mold, but in the bottom, it's difficult to see in this lighting, but there's a video on my channel. I used two silicone rubber pieces because due to shrinkage of the rubber after hardening, it would pressure itself on those two ridges. It was very difficult to get off and the mold was breaking. So by using silicone rubber mold parts, they can move with it. And parts like that, they have to evolve. So you make one, you cast one, and you see what's going wrong, and you adapt to it.
How many of those did you end up needing to make?
For our tank, the first time I made 10 and a few spares, but of course they got burnt. And then about the same again, but for other projects, I think in total about 200 were made.
What are some of the other things that you have to like make from scratch for this restoration project?
The biggest things that we made from scratch, that's now the for the gun, for the elevation and traversing mechanism.
You can see on this back view from behind that that's completely missing. So this is something that you've had to draw up and craft yourself.
Close by it was a monument of a Pack 43, a tone version on the single axle, so that's an early version. But the mounting system is exactly the same as used in the Nashorn. So the only thing is that the pivot pin for traversing, they disconnect it and then can put it on the Nashorn, and the shield is different. But the rest is exactly the same. So we go there and measure everything and put it in a 3D system and a cut design.
So with the elevation mechanism here, is that the next step that you have to cut and build?
Yeah.
Okay.
So we start at the bottom part. That part sits on, you can see here the gun, and this is the, it's like the hood of the engine of the Nashorn, because it's a mid-engine, and on that it's the gun, the cradle system will sit. So the traversing part is the first part that sits on the deck, so that makes sense to start with the bottom part.
Excellent, just build all the way up.
Yeah.
Tell me a little bit about your background that gives you like the know-how to be able to do this, since this is something you're doing with your own hands.
I always work with my hands, technical jobs, welding, mechanic, truck driver. I did a lot of things. So for me, technically, things are simple.
So if you don't know how to do it, then you just sit down and figure it out.
Yeah.
Okay.
Just look at it and see what it makes it move.
Right on. What was the program that you used to model the traverse and elevation mechanisms?
Inventor. It's an Autodesk program.
Oh. Then you do your drawings, you make your cuts.
Yeah.
And put it together.
Yes. We make the drafts. There's another guy in the team that also works with Inventor. He has a lot of more knowledge with that program because he worked with it for, I think, 20 years or so. And then, he also helps me out when I am not able to figure something out, how to create it in the 3D program. And, also printing the 2D drawings. And from that, we'll work to get it on steel and cut it out by hand, by plasma torch.
That part is pretty cool. Like, and that shows a little bit about why it's important to keep the history around.
Yeah, especially. You know. Difficult to make if you have a part that you cannot use anymore for the part itself, but it still shows the shape. You can see, okay, it's this long, it's this thick. You can get dimension from it, and you can recreate it.
Absolutely. You can't necessarily get that from a picture that's just in a book.
To recreate from a picture, but it's so difficult because the picture is never on the correct angle.
Hmm. Right. So is this something, is Hilary Doyle somebody that's helped you a lot to go to and to consult for this sort of project?
He gave us some of his drawings, and we talked Militrax with him about the project, and wherever he can help with information, he will.
Cool.
So really valuable.
Because I know that when most people think restoring German vehicles from World War II, they think of Hilary Doyle and they think of the Wheel Foundation. Hilary Doyle was a trustee, and that's a good team putting those things together. So I know a lot of people have probably seen the video of them giving you guys the first two old reels for what you needed at Militrax last year.
Surprise. Hilary came to me, I have a little surprise for you. And I thought, okay, what could that be? Like a book or something with information, but then they came with two wheels. So then later we put the wheels on with Hilary together, and they're still on it.
That was really special. That was cool. How did you get the original tracks that you had, the ones that are breaking, how did you get a hold of those?
Some came with the initial buy of the project, and others we bought from several people. Yeah, just calling around, you know, people in the same business, and you ask them, what do you have? And our goal was to get all of the same model, because, you can throw everything together. I think there are like 13 or 14 different models of track that would fit. And we really wanted to have everything single model as it came from the factory.
That makes sense.
Yeah. But yeah, unfortunately, this model is not as strong as the later models.
How long would you estimate until you would be ready to say that this thing is done?
Probably never. Something. Proof, or you find out we did something wrong. But to get it ready at the point that we say, okay, this is where we want to be at, it's probably a year.
Okay.
And then we want to do some reenactment events or other shows before we sell it so that we can buy another project. Because our goal is to have these vehicles back in running condition.
Cool. Yeah, it takes a village. How many people are on your crew to bring the Phoenix back to life?
The main crew is about 8 to 10 people, but of course there's also the kids that help out every now and then, the wives that come along with a fan day at Overload to help with selling the merchandise. It's about 20, 25 people.
That's cool. What are some of the events that you guys are planning on attending with the Nashorn?
Of course, at Militrax Overload, but also Tankfest in the UK. You have Yorkshire Wartime Show in the UK. You have Sahara in, I think it's Czech Republic, I'm not sure. So we have quite a few big events that we can go to, but also smaller local ones. There's a new upcoming event in Germany, Wheels and Tracks. Not last year, but the year before was the first time they organized it, and it was also really nice. It's similar to Militrax.
And then how are some of the ways that people can help you?
We have a GoFundMe page. So if you want to donate, you can go there. But we also have merchandise, the hoodie wearing. This older model, but in the back there's the grayer, the new model. And we have shirts, we have mugs.
Very nice.
And if you know any part for sale, information that could help a project, everything is welcome.
Awesome.
Even just sharing the channel or a Facebook page, that's every help is welcome.
Awesome. I'll make sure that those are linked down below so that you guys can follow along. Don't forget to like the Nasun Restorations channel, Jack of All Trades, as well as the Facebook page. And you guys can keep up with the regular updates and see some of the problem solving going on, as well as dates for events that it's going to attend so that you can see it too. If you guys have any questions about the project or any of the details, feel free to ask down in the comments below, or you can check them out over on the Facebook page or on the Jack of All Trades channel and ask directly. We'll have some follow-up answers to some of y'all questions if you leave them here for us.